Okay, so then the topic for the next hour is to try to get a first feeling for how the interaction of these magnetization processes in the sample with the recording equipment of the MR scanner can give rise to something like images. And the real 2D imaging we will do in the hour afterwards, but for the moment we will also get a feeling how differences in T1 time constants between different tissue types, for example, can be imaged. And the important thing behind all of this and to understand this are actually these two equations here. So they are a little bit less complex than the full block equation, and what you should get from them, of course you have seen these kind of functions or equations in school, and you also plotted them, so something like x squared or 3x plus 4 or something like that, you plotted them, and the same kind of idea you should just have here. So what you see here, this graph of this function that goes up, is just plotted, or is just the graph of this function. So it's just plotting for different values of t this equation here. So some value m0 times 1 minus the exponential of t, so t is what you would have as x usually, and then divided by t1, and m0 and t1 are both constants. So if you want to make a graph of this in I don't know, Python or MATLAB, you will just get this graph. And this, as we discussed earlier, describes the rebuild of the longitudinal component of the net magnetization. And the other process that is of interest is the decay. So this is just this function. You also see that's a little bit different, because this is this saturation kinetic, if you want, and this is just an exponential decay. This describes the length of the net magnetization in the xy plane, which you, if you encode this as a 2D vector, it's essentially the norm of this vector, so the square of each component and the root of that, or if you encode it as it's actually encoded as a complex number, then it's the absolute value of this. And that's something we'll see later. Now, these two processes, they are important to understand how T1 or T2 weighted images can be generated. That's the topic now. So what is developed on this slide is a signal contrast equation. So that explains then how one can use different times of sending the excitation pulse and different times of acquiring the data to emphasize certain features or certain tissue properties of a sample. So the whole thing starts again with the decay in the transverse plane, and the important thing is that this decay starts out with at the level of m0, because if you have 0 as time t, then the exponential of 0 is just 1, and then the first value you get at time 0 is m0, and then it decays. We've just seen this on this graph. Now, thing is, if the time between two of these excitation pulses does not allow for full recovery in the z direction, then the m0, that is the equilibrium magnetization, is also not fully there where it's supposed to be. So if you think again in this terms of this equation, if you let this little t here go to infinity, then you are back at m0. But if you scent and excitation pulse again at the time when this recovery has not fully happened, then what you see in the beginning when you tip the net magnetization into the XY plane in terms of the length of this arrow is smaller. Yeah, so essentially, if you if this is the rebuild and you tip the T1 again into the XY plane at this point in time, so here 2 seconds, then you start here. But if you already at this point in time send a new excitation, then you will the first thing that you will measure at time zero in the XY plane will also be lower than one, so in this case 0.8. So this now is a function of when you send the excitation pulse, and this time between excitation pulses is also known as repetition time or TR. So that's this TR time that you, I guess, seen in fMRI papers. Or yeah, at least I hope. Now this still describes the XY component as a function of time, and now depending also on the time between excitation pulses. There is another process in MR signal equation, which we actually don't detail here. At one point I should also include that. That's the idea of an echo. The most important thing for what we need this for in terms of contrast is that the MR signal acquisition actually happens at a time point called echo time or TE. So the way you should think about it is, okay, we can measure something after excitation, but this changes after excitation, and we now want a single number after excitation, so one data point, and then this the value that we get in terms of the magnetization, of course, depends on when we measure that, and the measurement time point after excitation is referred to as echo time. Of course, there's a longer story behind why it's called echo, but for us, it's enough to say state that at echo time the MR signal is acquired. Now the issue then is these T1 and T2 time constants that determine how fast this is, for example, decaying or this is rebuilding. So this can of course also rebuild like this, or it rebuilds very slowly, or this can decay very fast or very slowly. These are tissue properties. Yeah. So if you have two tissues, tissue A and B, so for example gray and white matter, then the difference in the signal that is acquired at the echo time for these two tissues is given by this difference here. So this would be the signal acquired at echo time for given TR in tissue A, where there's the T1A constant and the T2A constant, so A for the tissue. And the signal that you would get in tissue B is likewise determined by when you acquire the data. You do that for both tissues at the same time. The when the TR was sent again, and the corresponding tissue type B time constants. And now the idea is to play with the TR time or the TE time, which are parameters of imaging sequence. So if you read fMRI papers, you will always find what the TR was or what the TE was. And if you, if you're actually scanning, then you will just get a sequence, but it will have a specific TR and TE. So you don't have to set that yourself usually, but somebody will advise you that this might be a good idea. So in terms of the time constants, these T1 and T2 time constants, these are examples. So as discussed earlier, the T1 relaxation is a lot slower than the or the T1 relaxation, as it's called, or the recovery of the Z magnetization is a lot slower, so that the time constant here is on the order of seconds. So you see 1.4 milliseconds for white matter, for gray matter, sorry, and 1.1 seconds for white matter. The important thing is that, first of all, they are different, but also between the two tissues, it's different due to the tissue properties. And this is then one, of course, this has to do with what kind of microscopic or what kind of molecular, what this of course depends on the molecular structure of the tissues and how this molecular structure determines how hydrogen nuclei in the water molecules in these structures behave. Yeah? So where exactly these differences come from, this of course not what we discuss now. And the same for T2, the time constants between gray and white matter are different. And this means that if we emphasize differences between the T1 values, for example, we can see difference between gray and white matter. So the first thing then that one is or usually can be interested in, or that is easiest actually to introduce, is what is known as a proton density contrast, which aims at just characterizing the net magnetization at equilibrium. So remember that the entire sample, or at least, so by sample I now mean, sometimes I mean the entire brain and sometimes I mean a part of the brain. Now you should think of as a part of the brain, namely tissue A and tissue B. At equilibrium, the net magnetization has its extension in the Z direction, and the question is how large is this Z net magnetization. Now, to measure that, the crucial thing is to take a TR. If you do multiple measurements, because you not only want to do one measurement but multiple so that you can average over them, to take a TR that allows for the full recovery. Yeah. So if you are interested in measuring just the net magnetization, then you are not interested in these differences between the T1 and the T2 time constants, but you are interested in the net magnetization at equilibrium. So that would mean you leave the sample unexcited for quite some time, and then you are actually interested in measuring the net magnetization in the XY plane, which is the only place where you can measure it, as early as possible. Yeah, because you want to actually observe this this net magnetization at equilibrium, which is the first thing. So after at time zero, which you see in the XY plane, and afterwards in the XY plane, things decay. So. Yeah, so this is basically summarizing this. So the aim is to create a contrast between different tissues based on the proton density, which again, meaning that if there are more protons per unit space, then the net magnetization at equilibrium of this tissue is higher as compared if there are fewer protons per unit space. So that's why proton density. Proton density corresponding to the net magnetization of A and B, and this M0 was the initial or equilibrium magnetization. And what you want to not actually detect are differences that are due to differences in the time constants. So to essentially minimize differences in the time constants, you want this term in the contrast equation that was on the previous, or it's referring to this equation here, you want the term that deals with the T1 constant to be essentially 1. So you want a very long TR so that the exponential term here goes to 0 and you just multiply the M0A and M0B by 1. So you use a long TR to allow for full longitudinal recovery. And you also want to minimize the T2 contrast, so you essentially want the TE to be roughly at 0, so that you just get the whole M0A and M0B measurement. And how does something like that look? So without now, of course, explaining how this image comes about, you nevertheless see that there are different tissue types, and the different tissue types show up in different signal intensities. And a typical proton density contrast with a long TR and a short TE, these gradient time courses you can ignore. We will talk about them in a second on Fourier imaging. This proton density contrast has a high brightness or proton density in the ventricles, well, yeah, somewhat high, intermediate in gray matter, and relatively low in the white matter. Well, essentially, where you have a bit more water and less fat, there you have a brighter signal. So that's the proton density contrast. And this is just measuring the net magnetization. The other two important contrasts that you, of course, hear about all the time are T1 and T2 time contrasts. And T1 contrasts, of course, as the name says, want to emphasize differences in the T1 time constant. Yeah, that means you want to actually emphasize differences that are not happening at equilibrium, but you want to see which one of them actually builds up faster. So assuming now that they actually have the same equilibrium value, then if you have two different T1 time constants, the contrast, so the differences between the red and the blue curve, so of tissue A and tissue B, has this kind of profile. And as you detect things always only if they are tipped into the XY plane, you want to set the TR, so the tipping the net magnetization in the into the XY plane, at such a time point where the difference in terms of the recovery in each of these tissues is maximal. Yeah, and again, because you want to measure this thing that comes from the from the recovery process along the longitudinal axis, you want to acquire the data as fast as possible, and any differences in terms of the T2 recovery that are governed by the T2 time constant, you want to ignore. So again, you would take a short echo time, meaning the time at when you acquire the data. So again, you want to have a very short TE, roughly almost at 0, so that you just measure the difference in the M0 between the two tissue types, now affected by the recovery process, because the TR is too short to allow for full recovery. And T1 contrasts that are built, are based on this kind of logic, they are then these typical anatomical images where you have the white matter quite bright, the gray matter quite grayish, and the cerebrospinal fluid being dark. So this is then how they look, based on the differences of the T1 time constants between gray, white matter and the ventricles. And then finally, if you want to look at the T2 contrast, then of course again you don't then you are not interested in any differences between the net magnetization. So here we assume again that they are the same. If you cannot assume that they are the same, of course you need to first do a proton density image to figure out what actually the equilibrium values at a given point are, and then basically use this kind of as a normalization for the T2 or T1 contrast. So you don't, you here assuming that they have the same net magnetization equilibrium, you want to allow for full recovery, but then of course you don't want to measure things immediately after excitation, but then when the TE contrast is maximal. And of course this is not if you wait too long, because then everything is decayed in both tissue A and tissue B and you don't have any contrast anymore, but it's kind of at intermediate TE times, so in the order here of 30 milliseconds or so. So very short, very long TE, you would not observe the effect of the T2 differences, and you want to minimize the effect of the T1 dependence. And if you look at differences in the T2 behavior, so the spin-spin relaxation processes, then you get these kind of characteristic images where the cerebral spinal fluid is quite bright, intermediate is the gray matter is kind of intermediate, and the white matter gets quite dark. Yeah. So this is kind of the idea about this T1, T2 contrast. Yeah, that you have T1 proton density contrast, sorry, proton density contrast, T1 contrast, and T2 contrast. That by adjusting imaging parameters when you excite and when you acquire the data, you emphasize the intrinsic characteristics of different tissues that basically give rise to different dynamic behavior of the hydrogen nuclei in these different tissues. Good. Any question about these static contrasts? Not right now, it seemed to be relatively clear. So this used to be the end of my introduction to the physics stuff, so this is why there's a summary, but I think it's also nice to have an intermediate summary now, if you don't mind. So the basic thing is that these hydrogen nuclei have spin and can be regarded as little magnets. They align with the external magnetic field in parallel and antiparallel, because there's a little bit more in the parallel state. There is a net magnetization in the direction of the external field, so this kind of phenomenon that by having a strong magnetic field and a biological sample in that, the biological sample itself becomes a little magnet. Then that this whole thing is of course happening under precession circumstances or conditions. That means that by applying electromagnetic waves in the form of fast changing magnetic fields, you can change this and put the net magnetization into the transverse plane. We have the relaxation process, and there are these two relaxation processes referred to as T1 and T2 as the with the respective time constants. Important thing one always needs to keep in mind that the signal is actually only recorded from the transverse plane, and that the interaction of two properties and a signal are then used for imaging. What we haven't discussed yet, and with this summary you also notice, it's not clear how we now get an image from this. So if you think about these sample A and sample B, it's not clear how you can say sample A or tissue A is there in space and sample or tissue B is there in space. And this is what this business of Fourier imaging is then about. And this is what I wanted to talk about next. There, this will not be part of the oral exam. Actually, I taught this last year instead, so people could choose whether they want EEG or they want this, and we did this, but they could also do EEG based on the video lectures. So this is what I want to now tell you a little bit about. But before we do that, so something that you find now horrible, unclear, that you would like to clarify before we go into more stuff. Everybody's a bit exhausted, like me. Okay, so maybe it's also relatively clear, I don't know. So I find these all these processes, I find them relatively clear when talking about the net magnetization, because there are these few equations. Then kind of trying to motivate the net magnetization by the summed effects of all these little hydrogen nuclei. The stuff with the applying energy and switching between parallel and antiparallel spins, states of the spins and so on, like we discussed earlier, that's a little bit, at least for me, less clear. The good thing is that the Fourier imaging part works purely on these magnetic moment dynamics. So we are now talking about the net magnetization, but instead of only talking about the net magnetization as a function of time, so we have this one net magnetization vector that actually changes orientation over time, and its components in the x, y go away, in the z we build. We now think of these processes happening at over space, so that you essentially have multiple of these net magnetizations happening at different points in space. And of course, again, the idea is that what happens at a given point in space sums, so all the hydrogen nuclei in this area sum up to give rise to this one net magnetization vector in, like we saw earlier, tissue type A, tissue type B, and this is happening over space. So now you can think of kind of at the mesoscale that you have not these magnets referring to atoms, but referring to also not just the sum overall of space, but some kind of intermediate level of space. And so this is where this is happening, and it's starting again, of course, with the net magnetization vectors. We will see certain things again, and this is just the pointer to the chapter that I wrote on that in the dynamics part of probabilistic models for F functional new imaging. And there are also many video lectures. If you have nothing to do after this morning, then you can hear me talking for hours and hours and hours. You can also leave it on during the night, and I will just go on talking and talking. And as you can see here, there's also this introduction to differential equations and initial value problems, and integrations also with that. So if you feel like you want to, in this winter term, learn more about differential equations, although in statistical methods they will not show up anymore this year, there you also have a lot of material. There's also on the website, and there there's at least one chapter on for an introduction to differential equations. Good. And now this part, as indicated here, this will not be part of the oral exam. The nice thing about this is that we don't start completely from nowhere now, but we see the things that we've discussed already again. So we need certain ingredients, And the first ingredient that we need is a spatial-temporal model of the magnetic moments in the MR environment. So while we, and this is what this is supposed to indicate, while we previously looked at essentially one of these net magnetization vectors, or when we now talked about the contrast between two tissue types, two, we now think that these magnets, like I said, are everywhere over space. And in terms of the mathematical formulation, this then means that this 3D vector is a function of still of time, so a one-dimensional thing, but also of a of the three-dimensional position in space. And this three-dimensional position in space is this R. So R is x, y, z, and now to each location in space, we allocate for a given time point a three-dimensional vector. So that's kind of the picture here. Of course, this is formulated in continuous space, where you have to think that there are infinitely many of these little magnets, but of course this this is kind of mathematical convenience. You could also do it discretely if you wanted to, but then you would need many indices instead of having just a function of this 3D location. Yeah, so we basically extend the previous model from being a three-dimensional vector as a function of time to a three-dimensional vector that depends both on where it is and when it is. And what comes in as well. So what used to be there is the static magnetic field. We didn't make it explicit. It was just there in the Bloch equations. Like I said, they already accounted for this B0 effect. But now what the whole thing, so this is our B0 field, what this whole thing didn't need and what you might have felt was missing were the gradients, because I told you in the very beginning that the MR scanner also has gradient coils, and with these gradient coils, which can create magnetic fields in the X, Y, and Z direction, and which can be turned on and off, so the B0 field is always on and it's in the Z direction, the gradients that come from additional coils can change the magnetic field as a function of space. Now the important thing is that the entire the magnetic field, when it's represented as a vector, is still in the direction of in the longitudinal direction, so in the z direction. But now, depending, so that's the orientation. So this is why there's a x and y. The x y components are zero. But now the strength in the z direction depends on where you are in X, Y, and Z space. And this is this additional delta field, which is a function of space and time. And these gradient fields, so this delta B, this can be changed by the or is changed in during the imaging process, and how and why we will see. We still, of course, have these intrinsic properties of the image sample, and before we just had basically two locations that we are looking at, although when I showed you the picture there were of course more locations, but with the contrast equation we just looked at A and B, and now we are considering the T1 and the T2 time constants as a function of space, so again as a function of where in the 3D space we are. So basically at each point in space, there's a potentially different T1 or T2 time constant. And then finally, we need, as previously, we need this geomagnetic constant, which depends on the nucleus. And that's it. I thought there was coming something else because there's so much space here. Depending on the nucleus type, the frequency at which the magnets precess changes. So that's the diamagnetic constant. So this is then the Bloch equations or the Bloch equation again, but now, as you may notice, not only as a function of time, but a function of space and time. Yeah. So these R's are encoding the 3D location of the net magnetization. The T is still time. Another difference compared to what we've seen previously is that what is shown here are the Bloch equations in cross product form, which can be evaluated. So cross product is a specific mathematical operation where you basically you multiply, so you have two, so cross products, you have two, for example, 3D vectors, and the cross product is then defined as the differences between multiples of these entries. The fundamental ideas of a cross product, well, a physicist can explain what the cross product means, but then if you go first and then I go.
So generally what the cross product does?
No, yeah, what it encodes, if you think of, you have two vectors, you form the cross product, what is the...
You get a vector that's a perpendicular to both of the individual vectors.
Exactly, yeah. So, it depends on it depends on the angle between the vectors, how large this third vector is, which is perpendicular, right? Yeah, it does. So you can basically Spartproduktion. If they are completely parallel, then it's zero, it's maximal, and if they are 180 degrees apart, then it's zero maximal. Don't get it quite right now. But the thing is, in this case, what this is about and why it's invoked here and why it already gave rise to the Bloch equation as we saw it previously is the following. Let's see whether I get this right. The question is, where does this rotary movement come from? And the thing is that so the magnetic field is going in this direction. You have I don't get the intuition quite fully. One of these older lectures are there that explain it better. The important thing is that this rate of change, yeah, so this rate of change of the net magnetization vector, obviously, as we discussed earlier, gives rise is described by differential equations that describe this rotary movement. That means that the rate of change always needs to go into a specific direction, and the specific direction is encoded in this cross product and results from the fact how the I don't look at one of these old things. The important thing is you have this net magnetization vector, and its rate of change says go in this direction. Then it says go in this direction, go in this direction, go in this direction. And by going into the specific direction, what results in the end is this precession movement. And the results. And is encoded in this cross product form. Bottom line here is that when we looked at the Bloch equation previously, we saw the same thing, so that we had these constants that was asked about, so this Cx and Cy constants, and they are a function of the B0 field. So this is what's happening here. So the B0 and the gyromagnetic constant evaluated together, as we saw earlier, or the multiple here is the Lama frequency. And so we have seen in the exact equations before, here's a little bit more of physical and mathematical model building behind that. So that's the only difference here. The other difference compared to what we've seen previously is that now, instead of only having the product of the German magnetic constant and the B0 field, or the strength of the B0 field, there is an additional term that comes in due to the gradient fields. Yeah. So this delta B, again, these are potentially space and time varying gradient fields that determine together with the German magnetic constant and the constant z-oriented field, rotationary properties of the net magnetization in x and y. Yeah. So if you compare the equations from earlier, the only thing that is different is actually this, and everything else that's different is due to typo. The fact that we now look at these things as a function of space. So everything here is now a function of space. The German magnetic constant and the zero strength of the magnetic field in the z direction is not a function of space. And yeah, so this is again the Bloch equation, now explicitly as a function of space. And the solution then is also fairly similar with one key difference. So what is similar is that if you solve this and you look for the function that actually fulfills this rate of change, what is similar is that in x and y you have these exponential decays as a function of t2. You have this rotary movement, which is encoded by this cosine at times a frequency of t, plus the sine and the frequency times t for x, and then the cosine and the minus here in the for the y component. So this is the same. So it's also not really intuitive to see how a cosine omega t plus sine omega t and the cosine minus the sine and the y component describe a rotation movement, but if you put in numbers, you will see that this actually happens. So if you put in different numbers for t and plot them, then you see these things. The important difference here is that now it's also important what happens with this additional gradient field. And as the whole thing, if you solve a differential equation, corresponds to doing the anti operation to differentiation, namely forming the antiderivative or integrating, it's somewhat intuitive to appreciate that the additional argument of the cosine and the sine that plays a role here is given by the integral over time of the gradient magnetic fields. So this is basically, if you solve, instead of solving the Bloch equations without this, then we would have then you get what we got earlier. If you solve the Bloch equation with this additional function of the z magnetic field component as a function of space and time, then you get these integral terms in there, where the integral is taken from time 0 to time t. Again, I think the notation has slightly changed now. So it used to be m0, big m0, and now the big m0 is mx, my, and mz. And I think it was m0, so that was used to be a big m0x, big m0y, big m0z. And yeah, so this is again what these equations specify. In this case, I think for non-varying magnetic fields, this is just if you go to my chapter there, that's online. This is also, of course, coming with MATLAB code. And if you just basically plug in time here, so time evolving from 0 to, let's say, 1000, and you do that at one location, then you get this. And what I do here is, on the one hand, I basically just plug in time here. The other thing is a numerical solution where you specify only the rate of change and yeah, basically let the computer do the integration, and I'm just comparing that here. So essentially not much has changed so far. It's basically the same magnetic moment dynamics, with the difference that we are looking at them now as a function of space. So there's the R, where the R here is of course fixed, and we look at them in the presence of additional time and space varying magnetic fields. And what happens then, we hear after another break, because that's then the high point of today's lecture, after the break. So